to say what I think he said?
Is this it? This is what I got all those ass whoopings for? I had a dream once. It was a dream that little black boys and little black girls would drink from the river of prosperity, freed from the thirst of oppression. But lo and behold, some 4 decades later, what have I found but a bunch of trifling, shiftless, good-for-nothing niggas? And I know some of you don't want to hear me say that word. It's the ugliest word in the English language. But that's what I see now. Niggas. And you don't want to be a nigger. Cause niggas are living contradictions. Niggas are full of unfulfilled ambitions. Niggas wax and wane. Niggas love to complain. Niggas love to hear themselves talk but hate to explain. Niggas love being another man's judge and jury. Niggas procrastinate until it's time to worry. Niggas love to be late. Niggas hate to hurry. Black Entertainment Television is the worst thing I've ever seen in my life. Usher, Michael Jackson is not a genre of music. And now I'd like to talk about Soul Plane. I've seen what's around the corner. I've seen what's over the horizon. And I promise you, you niggas have nothing to celebrate. And no, I won't get there with you. I'm going to Canada.
This is Imperial Carter. You tune in live with Flyboy Radio. Sorry about the long intro. I think it goes with the theme that I'm, the ongoing theme that I've had since my last radio show, which is the debate about the word nigga. The Boondocks is definitely one of my favorite cartoons. It's kind of funny. I don't know, a lot of you guys have probably seen it, but if you haven't, go check out the Boondocks. They got 3 seasons. But it just makes you think, if Dr. Martin Luther King was here today, how would he feel about the use of the word nigga? And, you know, the youth culture, you know, people are under 30 that are using it. You know, would he be ashamed? Would he be pissed off? Would he be embarrassed of us with all the things that he went through and the people that lived through the civil rights era have gone through, the things that they fought to make our lives better? So it's just food for thought. But we're going to get into a song. Here's a Q-Tip, the Renaissance remix by J. Period. And we'll be right back after the break.
I'm just a rubber man descending of the motherland. I f*** with blackberries and dimes of butter tans. Good on my right hand, trouble on my other hand. Life is a tightrope, I'm dying to balance in. And by the end, hopefully I'll be the balance man. A simple dude who can exude the talents in. I am the captain of the hot-blooded caravan. Spreading a different look through charred and battered land. Inside the function, I see girls that can top it off. I hold mines while these cowboys pop it off. You're just a movie dude claiming that you pops off. This shit's like cold grits without the hot sauce. This government seems to me like it's off course.
Come on, come on, let's move and get down
like it's off course.
Come on, come on, let's move.
This government
and get down. Come on, come on, let's move and get down.
Ride with me, come on.
Come on, come on, let's move
one more time.
Get down.
Your dubious style may rock for right now, but in the long run, you really lost one. Jamaica, Queens, man, land up the toss gun. It's never easy, police not sees we. Go through the checkpoints, birds flip to pole 9. I got a bad bird, nicknamed the sunshine. My cheeks are so kind, sweet nothings at nighttime. Into the right tunes, we hit the right rhymes. I dig a fashion to my memory. And in the club, shorty stays your enemy. A humble dude and never will pretend to be the type of artist that's desired for the industry. Came in the to me, and I'ma leave me, and in the end be, you will believe me, that I'ma leave me, so what's the industry, if the listeners will always stand beside me, me, me.
Come on, come on, let's move, and get down, 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 here we come, yeah. Here we come, 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 here we come, yeah. Here we come.
Abstract, you know my sticky D in here. Come on. Abstract.
Yo, this is Imperial Carter. I'm back here live with my boy King Joe the Great, and you know, he's gonna weigh in on, you know, the topic, you know, just on niggas and shit, like the word. Anyway, why don't you introduce yourself to people?
Hey, what's up? It's your boy Too Legit, you know, just coming in from Miami, Florida. I'm representing Dayton, North Miami, West Side. What up?
Yeah, man, so I don't know if you know, there's been a big uproar over the word nigga and its use. You know, I know in the music industry, there's this girl, you know, her name is Be Nasty. She's from the White Girl Mob. She's from Oakland, and she's been just, like, saying the word nigga just, like, freely, you know. But she's using it in the content that is used now, you know, like, just homie. You know, she's not being like, oh, these black niggas, these fucking niggas, or she's just saying nigga, but people are mad at it. People are mad at her about that. I mean, how do you feel about, you know, other ethnicities using the word nigga, man? Does that bother you?
I mean, the word nigga, I mean, when it comes to another black person saying nigga, like, you know, it's like an everyday thing. It's like saying dog. It's like saying, you know, what's up, dude? Or, like, what's up, homie? Or, you know, like Spanish people say essay. Like, and we just adapted to it. Like, you know, ever since I was a child, you know, we were saying niggas to each other like it was nothing. You know, so, I don't know. It's supposed to be a word that we're not supposed to use, and I was taught that. But even though you were taught that, that word was terrible, and it's something that you ain't supposed to use, you know, then every day in my life, there's other people that's using it. You know, you come home, and, well, for me, I come home, and, you know, I'm listening to my brothers, and then they saying it amongst each other. I go to school, you know, my peers saying it to each other, and it's just something I grew up to say for years. But, yeah, that word, I do agree, is bad, but, you know, it's just trying to kick out the habit.
So, if you had a white homeboy or white homegirl, and you knew them for years, would you allow them to say the word nigga to you?
No.
And why is that?
It'll feel very funny. Like, I don't know. Like, every time I hear, like, you know, like, somebody like Don Emmons, or, you know, every time I hear that somebody, a Caucasian, says the word, you know, it offends me a lot, and I know it's wrong. It's like a, I mean, it's how can I say, it's an irony, it's, you know, it's hypocrisy, but I don't know, it offends me to see them say that, because I don't know what they really mean by their heart. I mean, maybe they're saying it like homeboy or homie too, but I don't know what's in their heart.
Right. I mean, with me, it's just, like I said, I don't know if you heard the last show, but I was like, I don't know how I would feel. Like, I've never, like you said, I never had one of my white homeboys to be like, oh, yo, my nigga. That's never happened in my lifetime. But what I do see, like I said, is I see, like, you know, like Mexicans or Puerto Ricans, just like Latinas or Latinos or whatever. They use the word a lot of times. Like I said, in my last show, I was at school. I remember in high school, like, that was like 5-6 years ago. And I'd be hearing some dudes be like, yo, nigga, nigga this, nigga that. And then I look around, and it's a gang of Mexicans. I'd be like, oh, shit, like, you know, I did kind of feel uncomfortable, I'm not gonna lie, but like I said, a lot of times, you know, in this day and era, you hear a lot of kids using the word nigga, and they're not necessarily black. You know, I know you probably might have seen the same thing, you being in Florida. I know there's a lot of Spanish cats over there in Florida, so I'm not sure if you heard it, but I mean, when you hear chicos, or like you say chicos or whatever, or Latinos or whatever, saying the word, does that bother you too?
Altercation too much with chicos, you know, we, you know, it's here and there, you know, I had a few, you know, encounters with them, but other than that, like, most of the times, like, I thought, okay, I had some chicos that stayed in the same neighborhood, went to school with me as well, so, you know, they grew up along with us, and, you know, the fact that, you know, they came from, most of them came from the islands, or came from third world country, or another, you know, another place instead of the United States, and also that I feel like, you know, they're minorities as well. So when they use the word, like, I feel like it's like they're kind of like it's kind of like the same in a certain way, like, you know, understand her. And now she's talking like, you know, mayonnaise sandwich and, you know, I don't know. Like, you know, he's, like, he looks like he's a racist type, and it may be a problem, but,
Okay, so you're saying, like, basically, if you grew up with somebody that came from the same neighborhood, and, you know, if they're a Spanish descent or ethnicity, as I would call it, I wouldn't say race, because, like I said, I believe that race, you know, we're all one human race. It's not a bunch of different races. A lot of people say that. But anyway, if they came from the same neighborhood, the same lifestyle as you, as far as them being Spanish or Latino, that's a little bit more acceptable to you than say, a white person who might have came from the same type of background as you. You know, you're saying is that what you're saying?
I mean, and it's a double-edged sword to me. I mean, I know that's messed up, but that's just the way it's always been. Like, I know plenty of Spanish people, like, that, you know, they're like, what's up, my nigga? And I'm, you know, it's just, it's fluid to me. It's, you know, I adapted to it. And we're like, hey, you know, you come from the same boat as us. You know, some of them have, Native Americans, or, I mean, not Native Americans, but, like, Native descendants, and, some of them also have, you know, black in their cultures as well. But as far as that, so we feel like, you know, they're one of us. I mean, that's how it is in South Florida.
Okay, so I can see what you're saying. I don't know, like, I might agree with you a little bit, you know, I guess I see it a lot, especially, like, since I'm living currently in Texas right now, so there's a lot of Mexicans, so I hear them saying this shit all the time, but, I mean, it's a lot of people that I don't know, though, so it kind of makes me a little bit uncomfortable, because I don't know them. I know a lot of them probably came from a similar background. I'm not from the hood. I've been in the hood, you know, I'm really from the suburbs, so I know as far as a black person, I kind of come as an exception to the rule. But it's just like, with people that you don't know, it definitely does make you uncomfortable. So if somebody that's, you know, that you're familiar with, yeah, you might give them the chance to say it, probably. But as far as white people go, I think, you know, I don't know, it's probably a lot of people will be uncomfortable with it. Like I said, it's never happened to me. I've never seen it directed towards me, so I don't know my reaction towards it. You know, like I said, I had a couple of hood homeboys or whatever, just like urban homeboys, they're white, but they never ever said it to me. You know, I think it's definitely something that needs to be talked about. So I'm glad, you know, I got to weigh in with you, because you're one of my good homeboys. And, you know, I'm glad you told the truth. A lot of people will probably be like, they fake the phone. They'd be like, oh, nah, I never let my Mexican homeboy say it or my Chico homeboy say it. But, you know, you always been, yeah, you always keep it real. So I definitely had to weigh in with you. We couldn't get my boy Jay Vando on the phone. I told him about the interview, but I guess he probably was busy. So we'll probably have to weigh in with him next week. So I definitely appreciate, you know, you doing this with me for my show, man, and I'll put the link on your page or whatever so you can listen to it. I gotta add some music and stuff, but this is how the recording goes.
I mean, I appreciate you taking your time, you know, to interview people from different places, you know, West Coast, Midwest, and South. You know, like, three different perspectives, you know, and from, you know, a woman's perspective, and, you know, from a black male and from a white man. So, you know, you got it from three different diversities and three different regions. So people could understand from different views, and, you know, they have their different opinions. So I really like the way you think and the way you're running your show, man. So it does make sense. And like I said, it's a double-edged sword. There's a lot of irony to it, for real, because, I mean, I don't want it to get to where the point where people just start disrespecting and just start, everybody start using the word like it's nothing. To me, I feel as if that time ever happens or comes, it's like saying, like, oh, wells, you know, like, no respect at all, like, oh, wells, you know, and if they take our respect, then what else left do we have?
Right. You know? I don't know, like I was saying in my last show, I think that we probably should just do away with the word. I know it's going to be hard because the younger generation, you know, everybody uses it. Like I said, I've used it. I know you use it sometimes. But I really try to refrain from using it all the time, because I realized, you know, the background where it came from a derogatory source. You know, the slave owners called their slaves that. And we, even though we did flip it and we made it something better, it's just like sometimes you shouldn't use it. It's just like maybe we should just move away from it. Just like nobody should say it. But I know that's going to be hard because, like I said, it's a young generation that's really using it a lot now. And, you know, people have been using it for like the last 30, 40 years. It's hard to get people to change. A lot of people don't even think, you know, deeper into the problem. You know, so it's definitely going to be a struggle to get that type of stigma to change, man.
Are you saying that woman's being nasty, she still uses the word?
Yeah, man. If you If you look up, go look up on YouTube and type in V Nasty. And then, like, you'll see, like, in her conversations, she probably says it, like, 8-9 times. Like, just she's just talking about it. Like, yo, my niggas, these niggas. You know what I'm saying? My nigga from the block, and I was locked up, and these niggas. And
did she expect to have fans?
I mean, a lot of people are mad at her, and a lot of people are just like, oh, well, you know, she's saying a lot. But the most uproar that I've seen is from a lot of black women are mad. You know, mostly like the black women are mad. They're like, oh, why is she saying that it's some white hood rat? She's hanging around with black dudes or whatever. She probably fucks black dudes. And, you know, I think they're more mad that she may be fucking black dudes rather than her saying that we're a nigga. They just think, I mean, they do say that it's disrespectful. But, you know how that is. It's just like black women hate when black dudes are with white girls. So I think it's more of that terms. But another topic too, you know, that goes along right with what we're talking about is the word bitch. You know, a lot of females refer to themselves as bitches and shit. And then it's like, but if we call them a bitch, it's like, whoa, hold up. I don't know you, but you just said you were the queen bitch. So I'm just agreeing with you. You feel me? I know I was gonna touch on it in my last show, but I forgot. But I think it's something else we probably should talk about on this show too, man. I mean, what do you think about that? Like, if you see a girl that refers to herself as a bitch, and then like, have you ever just been like, yo, bitch? what happened?
Man, in elementary school, that shit got me so in trouble because the same thing happened to me. So, you know, I was a curious little kid. I said, "Ooh, you know, I was like, hey, how you doing, bitch?" And there's this girl named Rock, yo, man. She slapped the shit out of me. Man, I'm like, oh shit, the fuck? I said, damn, bitch, you know what I'm saying? Well, I can't call you a bitch, he just called you a bitch. Rock Hill was like, I know you ain't just driving me like that, and then she slapped me again. I was like, damn, you know? But I don't know, man, I think they should use the word at all. It's no reason, man, I can't use it. You right. Know, man, I don't think a man should call a woman a bitch just like that anyway, it's just like randomly. You know, I think a man should just have respect for a woman, no matter what ethnicity she is, or race, or color. You know, I think, you know, you should, I mean, that's a double-edged sword. You know, I ain't gonna lie. Because there were times I call women bitches, and, you know, out of vain. You know, if I felt like, you know, that's the way she was acting, or, you know, what she done, you know, or in relationships. But, you know, it was wrong. I could truly admit it was all wrong. And I was young and dumb back then, didn't know much. You know, but I think women, if they don't want to be called that, they shouldn't call each other that in the first place. You know, just like us. You know, we don't want people to call us niggas. We shouldn't say that to each other. And it's a crap that we should start practicing. But how are we going to get everybody else to start practicing it when we've been doing that our whole lives? And other, you know, our great-grandfather's been doing it, great. You know what I'm saying?
I mean, it's just like, you know, it's just like, you know, when Barack Obama, I'm sorry, I just said the same shit like twice. When Barack Obama was running for president, he was talking about change. I don't know necessarily he's done a lot of changes. He's tried, but that's the best what we can do as people, you know, is just try. You know, one person, all it takes is one person to take the lead and show, set the example. But a lot of people, you know, they're afraid of change and just progressing. People see the problem, and they're like, oh, it's too big. You know, there's nothing I can do as one person, but all it takes is one person to effectively make a change, and then other people will follow your example. You know, because people, by definition, a lot of them are followers. Then you don't have a lot of leaders. But if somebody was to step into the forefront and be like, okay, you know, this is a bad word, I'm not going to say it, and it would take somebody young. It wouldn't be an old person, because, you know, you got Bill Cosby, and he'd also be like, oh, see, what you got to do is don't say the word, because if you do, then you're a raccoon. It's like, we don't want to listen to him, because he's fucking uppity, you know what I'm saying? But if it was somebody like me or you or maybe somebody different, you know, maybe like a celebrity or something that took the forefront and really... Huh? Oh, Rick Ross?
Oh, God, you know, that word is crazy, man. You know, you ain't gonna come, huh? Yeah, he's right. Ross is right, though. Hey, man, Ross is talking. You know what I'm saying? They gotta listen to somebody that... You know, somebody that tell tales, like I said, you know, somebody that lived and went through some things or experienced some things. Like, that's what it takes for people to, you know, follow people nowadays. I don't know why.
Yeah, I mean, I think you're right, though, man. It would take somebody of that stature, of that nature, to really make a change, man. Because, like, if you look at it, look at our generation, man. We don't have a lot of the revolutionary heroes that we had back, like, in the 50s and 60s. We don't have the Malcolm X's, the Dr. Martin Luther King's, you know, those type of people. We don't have those type of people anymore. So now people are looking to celebrities and other people to try to make a change. But nobody really is really doing too much about socialism. You know, the one person that I see really, you know, making a stand as far as, like, politics is, like, you know, Lupe Fiasco. Like, he didn't even shake the president's hand and shit. So, you know, he has a particular opinion about Barack Obama. He said that in the news, he said that he's like the biggest terrorist, and he stood by that statement. You know, you only have a few people really willing to make a fucking statement. You know, there's not a lot of people that really care to do it anymore. So it would take somebody like a Rick Ross, you know, come here, little kid, like you were saying, to say some shit like that. Actually, I think one other person, actually, Chamillionaire, he doesn't even cuss anymore. I remember when he first came out, he was cussing, and then by, like, his third album, he said that he didn't cuss no more. So, I think that's a good thing, you know. A lot of people probably shouldn't cuss. I'm not saying that you should just do well with cuss words, because sometimes the only way to illustrate, you know, what you're saying is just to fucking cuss. But it's good that he took a stand, and he was like, you know what, I sound like an idiot, because I'm always cussing, saying, nigga, fuck this, whatever. And he was like, I'm not going to cuss in my music no more. And he's done that. So I think, you know, occasionally you have people that actually do stuff, you know, that make a stand. But you don't really have that a lot, though. That's few and far between. So
I don't know, man.
I mean, that just, you know, that evolves into a bigger problem. I think that, you know, we as black people, we haven't learned to love ourselves. You know, I know, like, in the slavery days, you know, the light-skinned person was more loved. They're like, oh, you know, they felt like they, I guess they were closer to white people, so they were more acceptable. And, you know, that's just carried down to society. You know, a lot of people, you know, prefer, I guess, you know, the light-skinned Americans. I've said this, you know, a lot of times, that if Barack Obama was as dark as I am or darker, he would not be president. And I really believe that shit. You know, we won't see the day when you'll see, like, a dark-skinned president as president. That's just not going to happen under my lifetime. And people are like, oh, why would you say that? The reason why I say that is because they can identify more with him, because they're like, oh, he's light-skinned, he must be safe. That's not, you know, I'm not trying to take anything away from Barack Obama, but that's what I truly feel like. If he was a dark-skinned dude, he would not be president. Not at all. So,
I think so. I agree with you, and I know Carter, he's 100% non-racist. It's just what it is. They made it seem like dark is an ugly color. Like, that's how people perceive things. You know, like, and that's all over the world, too. Because I have a few, you know, it's multi-culture down here, and I have a few friends from the Dominican Republic. And so that's how it is over the island, too. Like, you know, like, people make it seem like dark is nasty, is dirty, you know? And I don't know. We just gotta change the way that we think, you know, and we can make this world a better place, but
mean, I'm sure he said it, man. They had Reverend, what was it, Al Sharpton that said it? Like, he was on the show, and he was like, yo, that nigga think he got everybody fooled. Is he the one that said that about Barack? I know somebody famous said that shit. It might have been Jesse Jackson.
I think it was Jesse Jackson and Al Sharpton, man.
Yeah, but they caught him on camera talking about Barack Obama. I'm sure Barack Obama, as a black person, has used that word. I don't think he makes very, he doesn't use it often. I'm sure he has used it, though. I mean, like I said, it's something that not necessarily comes along with being black, but I think it's something that probably every black person has said at least once. I mean, I'm pretty sure he said it, you know. But I'm glad nobody caught him on tape saying it, because he would be president, you know. I'm sure every black person has said it at least once in a lifetime, you know. Even my mom, you know, as proper as she is and educated as she is, she's used it. But, you know, not very often. It's just that, you know, people say it. I know educated black people say that shit.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure, man. He said it. Shit, I just thought about it, man. For a record, I ain't gonna lie. I don't mean to be all subject, but it's a bad slap too when I was a kid for touching a butt. So, you know, just, I don't know what it was with me and her. It was just attraction. So,
you said, who'd you do that to? Okay.
I was on it,
though.
You know, I was on it.
That's what's up, man. I know this is off subject, but I remember when I was in the 8th grade, I told you about this, but I was messing with this girl's hair. Her name was Peaches, man, and her fucking weave just fell out of her hair. And I was scared, man. That was like the first time in my lifetime to ever really, you know, I really got exposed to weave. I didn't know what it was, and I was scared that her hair was falling out. I thought that something was wrong with it, and I just ran away. And then when I came back, you know, everybody was laughing and shit. And when I came back, she was like, oh, man. She was like, yeah, I got weave. I was like, what the hell is that? Like, I didn't even know. That was, like, my first experience with weave. You know, so it was just scary. You know, it was scary, man. It looked like some curly fries or some shit. I remember it was, like, red and yellow and blonde. And like, she really didn't have no hair, man. She had, like, one of them little baby ponytails, you know. So I was like, oh, wow. It was crazy, man. That's a show for... You said what?
I just wanted to throw a little different subject, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, people probably get heat up because, you know, the topic is kind of controversial.
Oh, shit. I don't care, man. If they don't like my show, they ain't got to listen. I hope people do listen. And I've seen people, you know, been tuning in. But you got to weigh in on controversy sometimes. But, yeah, man, I mean, the weave shit, that's a show. That's for another show, man. I could probably do, like, 5 shows out of that shit, dude. Yeah, I am. I don't know when I'm going to do it, but I've been writing a lot of ideas down. So when I do these shows, because, you know, I do these shows on once a week and I broadcast on Thursday. So that's definitely going to be a topic for a show, because I think that's another topic that should be touched on. You know, a lot of people might listen to my show and be like, oh, why do you always talk about things that are, you know, black? I told them, like, in the introduction, you know, it's a pro-black show. I'm going to talk about a lot of things, you know, within our culture. So it's definitely something that needs to be talked about, man. I think it should be promoted for natural hair, you know, not just weave shit. So. Yeah, man, I think I should use my show as a medium to, you know, to spread good music and knowledge. You know, I think that people will listen to a voice that's trying to, you know, move forward and talk about, you know, social change and the climate of things that need to be talked about as far as black people and culture goes. Of course, you know, like I said on my shows, I'm going to talk about, you know, different things, not just black culture and things that, you know, that affect us. But, you know, a lot of my topics will be over that. So I hope that people will listen and I hope that, you know, they'll get something from my show. I hope they don't get offended as far as my content, but I'm just talking about things that I believe that need to be talked about. You know, I'm a young black man and I see a lot of different things. So I hope that people will, you know, like I said, enjoy my show and be entertained, and they also will have a good learning experience from my show. You know, I want to get people to think. And that was my interview with my boy, King Joe the Great. He's a good friend of mine. We go back like 6 years, man. He's one of my top dudes. He's in my circle. So I like politicking with him about different topics because he always gives me some intelligent insight that I may not have thought of. And I just like to hear his opinion on different things. Next week will be the third and final episode of this series about the nigga debate. I hope to get my boy Jay Vandal on the phone. He's supposed to do this interview, so it'll be a three-way interview between, you know, me, King Joe, and him. But I guess maybe he probably forgot he was messing with some female. I don't know. But next week will be the third and final episode of this series. So, you know, I want to thank you guys for tuning in. The show's been kind of long, so I'm going to close it out with some R&B like I usually do. This is Frank Ocean with the song Love Crimes off his mixtape Nostalgia Ultra.
Crazy. I plead insanity. Crazy for your baby. Crazy, na na. Yeah. Talk to me, and I better not hear a word. Better not feel it, girl. Baby, I still got one bullet left in my knife. Finna do a love crime. Love crime. Finna do a love crime. Murder, 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 she knows. Love crime, tell me it's a love crime.
you're not the jealous type, are you? You've never been jealous about me, have you? And why haven't you ever been jealous about me? You are very, very sure of yourself, aren't you?